أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. الحمد لله نحمده ونسكنه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, we praise Allah the Almighty. We believe in Him, we trust in Him, we bear witness that none deserves to be worshipped except Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's messenger and servant. We ask Allah to bless His messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam and his family and his companions. Ameen.
Ameen.
Brothers and sisters, what a magnificent day this is. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us and honored us in ways that you cannot imagine. I'd like to do two things today. Number one, I want to rehearse to you why we are celebrating today, which is part one. And then I want to finish with part two, that we've done something today. The last 30 days we did something, but we're not finished yet. That's part two. I want to talk about that, inshallah. Recently, the United Nations put out a report of the happiest nations in the world. And I studied that list. They talked about the happiest nations in the world. The 10th happiest nation in the world, Sweden. 9th, Canada. 8th, Australia. 7th, Finland. 6th, Israel. 5th, Austria. 4th, Switzerland. 3rd, Netherlands. 2nd, Norway. And this report, they said, the happiest nation in the world, Denmark.
I knew that.
And then they list the unhappiest nations in the world. And all the unhappiest nations in the world were all the poorest nations. And I would like to dispute this. I want to remind you what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to see why we are celebrating today, this day of the Eid. وَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِلصَّائِمِ فَرْحَتَانِ يَفْرُهُمَا إِذَا أَفْطَرَ فَرِحَ بِفِطْرِهِ. For those who fast, there are 2 days, 2 moments of great happiness. When they break their fast, they're happy with breaking their fast. I remember in the first day of Ramadan, I was in Atlanta, Georgia. And the iftar was 8:45 p.m. It was a hot day. And you know what happens when it's Ramadan? When it gets to be like 1 hour before the fast ends, you're looking at your watch and you say, is it time yet? Wallahi, at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm looking at my clock saying, is it time to break the fast yet? And then I'm waiting, it seemed like 1 hour. I look at my watch again, only 1 minute went by. But oh, subhanAllah, when the time came to break the fast, what a magnificent feeling. It is something that people would never imagine until you do it. When you fast for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all those hours, and then when it comes time to break the fast, all of our energy is on that. I go to the brothers in the masjid, and they break in their fast, and everybody's eating, everybody's happy. So this is the day of fitr. We are happy today. We're happy today because of the great gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, the fast of Ramadan. But remember what the Prophet said, وَإِذَا لَقِيَ رَبَّهُ فَرِحَ بِصَوْمِهِ. And when they meet their Lord on Yawm al-Qiyamah, they're going to be happy for their fast. What will we get for this fast? Why should we be so happy? Right now, you ought to be happy. You're not fasting today. Good. You ought to be happy. It's a joyous occasion. And why should we be so joyous? A couple of things. Our Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, said according to Abu Dharr and Mu'adh bin Jabal, اتَّقِ لَا حَيْثُ مَا كُنْتَ. Ey Allah, wherever you are, وَأَدْبِ السَّيِّئَاتِ حَسَنًا تَمْهُوهَا. Ey Allah, wherever you are, and follow a bad deed with a good deed, it will wipe it out. The wonderful thing about Ramadan, about the fast of Ramadan, all of the bad deeds that we did, alhamdulillah, Ramadan wipes it out. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من صوم رمضان إيمان واحتسام كفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever fasts in the month of Ramadan with iman, faith, and seeking a reward from Allah, Allah will forgive them their past deeds. And the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, said, من قام رمضان إيمان واحتسام كفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever stands in the month of Ramadan, Salat al-Taraweeh, Salat al-Hajj, Qiyam al-Layl, whoever stands in the month of Ramadan with iman, seeking a reward from Allah, Allah forgive him his past sins. ومن قام ليلة القدر إيمان واحتسام كفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. And whoever stands in ليلة القدر with faith, seeking a reward from Allah, Allah forgive him his past sins. So it's clear. Doing good deeds wipe out bad deeds. That's good. Now, brothers and sisters, do you remember recently the people in the Sikh, I think in Wisconsin, the temple, how some Sikh followers and worshippers were killed? I did something very minor. In New York City, when I go running, a block before the track, there's a man, a Sikh man, he's there every day selling his newspapers. After those people were murdered, I went to him, I drove up to him, I opened up my window, I said, you're a Sikh, aren't you? He said, yes. I said, give me a newspaper. I'd already bought the paper. I bought a newspaper that cost $1. He said, $1. I gave him $20. And he went to give me my change. I said, no, keep the change. And he had such a smile on his face, and he did like this to me. I'm a Muslim, he's a Sikh. What I did was so minor, but for that one man, he felt something. He felt some kind of kinship with a Muslim. All I did is give him $20, no big thing, but that man would never forget that. Never forget that. We are trying to do good deeds. Brothers and sisters, Allah the Almighty finds so many ways to teach us. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Glory be to you, O Allah. We have no knowledge except for what you have given to us. You are the knowing and the wise. So there are many ways that Allah teaches us. How does Allah teach us? Number one, from Al-Quran. خلق من تعلم القرآن وعلم. The best of you, those who learn the Quran and teach it. How does Allah teach us? Through the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And yet, there is one more way. Another way of Allah teaches us.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
ألم ترى أن الله سخر لكم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض. Don't you see? Allah has subjected for you everything in the heavens and the earth. Look how Allah has honored the children of Adam. Everything Allah has subjected for us in the heavens and the earth. You take a dog. Muslims don't have dogs. But yet if you study dogs, a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will teach us if you open up our eyes. Do you know that there are dogs now that are trained? Because dogs have to smell it millions of times more sensitive than human beings. They are now trained dogs to smell the urine of a man to detect cancer. They have a keen sense of smell. I remember I took my wife to Australia, and when we landed on Australia, we went to the luggage claim to get our luggage, and there was a security man with a dog. And the dog was going around smelling all the luggage. And then that dog started smelling my wife's luggage. And I know that the dog is smelling for one of three reasons. Number one, maybe there's drugs. I started looking at my wife. Or maybe they're looking for bombs. I started walking away from my wife. Or maybe they're looking for food. And sure enough, when they opened up the luggage of my wife, there was some food. For in Australia, they don't allow you to bring food into the country. So these dogs are very sensitive. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them to us for a reason, like all of the animals. So here we have a hadith. A prostitute was thirsty, and she went in the well and got water. And when she came out, she saw a dog. And she said, this dog is at thirst just like me. And so she took off her shoe and went down into the well and put water in the shoe and put the shoe in her mouth and climbed out of the well and gave a dog water. And the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah appreciated that and forgave her sins. A dog. Imagine that. But remember, it ain't over yet. You did good, alhamdulillah, you fasted. And you know something about Allah? Allah didn't forgive nobody. Because He knew that in His ummah, there are some, وَمَنْ كَنَا مِنْكُمْ مَرِيدًا أَوَلَا سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٍ مِنَا يَذِكُهَا. Okay, some of you are sick, some of you are traveling, I know that. All you got to do is make it up. And yet in this ummah, there are other people that can't fast. They can't fast like you. When it comes time to break the fast, they ate already. They don't have the same kind of happiness for you, but Allah didn't forgive them. He gave them an opportunity to feed the poor. So Allah will reward them on Yawm al-Qiyamah. وَإِذَا لَقِيَ رَبُّهُ فَرِحَ بِصَوْمِهِ. And when they meet Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah, they will be happy for their fast. What do we get on Yawm al-Qiyamah? The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, he gave us a clue. Just a hint. A clue. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam binakatin makhtuma. He came with a camel that was muzzled. And the man said, Hadi fi sabilillah. This is for in the way of Allah. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam said, Laka biha yawm al-qiyamah sabiliyatin nakatin kulluhu makhtuma. For you, because of this camel that you gave, mahtuma, muzzled, on the day of judgment, you will have 700 camels, each one of them muzzled. Can you imagine? This is just a hint. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the Prophet said, "Kullu amil ibn Adam yudhaaf, yudhaaf." والحسنة بعشر والحسنة بعشر أمثالها إلى 700 دفعة. And a good deed will have a reward from 10 to 700. وقال الله عز وجل إلا سام إنه لي وأنا أجزي به. Except the fasting, I myself will reward them on يوم القيامة. What would it be like? You can't even imagine how much it is the great reward that Allah has for us. So inshallah, part one we did. What was part one? Part one we fasted for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah we got our sins removed. But now, part two. Walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. Brothers and sisters, after the good news, after the celebration, I feel it incumbent upon me to give a warning. You did good, you fasted, Ramadan is over, alhamdulillah. But now there's one more thing you have to do. You have to protect your fast. You have to protect your ibadah. Because the same way a good deed will wipe out a bad deed, bad deeds that wipe out good deeds. You did part one. Now you gotta do part two. 2 days ago I was in the masjid in Boonton, New Jersey. Beautiful community. And one of the brothers was bragging. He said, yeah, Imam, one night we thought it was later to Qadr. We stood and we prayed for hours. Imagine praying for hours and they stood praying. Imagine this. To me, everything is al-jannah. Allahumma la isha illa isha al-akhir. Prophet said, oh Allah, there's no life except the life of the hereafter. To me, everything is al-akhir hereafter, al-jannah. To me, everything is al-jannah. To avoid the hellfire and to go to al-jannah. Imagine on Yawm al-Qiyamah, you happy. I got all this fast, I fasted every year. I'm 70 years old, and I've been fasting since 5 years old. I'm 80 years old, I've been fasting for 75 years. And I got all of this fast that I did all those years, all of Qiyam, all of Tahajjud, all of Taraweeh, all of the Salat, I got all of that. And I can imagine us trying to get into the gate of Jannah. Can you imagine? Outside of the Jannah, you standing out the door and you waiting for them to call you from Battle Rayyan. All the fasting I did, I did the fast of Dawood, I fasted every other day, I fasted on Mondays and Thursdays, I fasted on Ramadan, I fasted 6 days in Shawwal. Surely I'm going to Rayyan, I'm going to that gate because I know I fasted. Can you imagine? You knocking on the door and you want to get in. But they don't let you in. And you can't understand why you can't get in. I fasted. I deprived myself. I fasted in August when it was hot, 105 degrees. I was thirsty and I fasted every day. But you won't be able to get in. You know why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the great teacher, asked his companions, "Atadruna man al-muflis?" Do you know what a muflis is? Do you know what a bankrupt person is? Qalu al-muflis fina man la dirham lahu wa la mata'. And his companions said, "A muflis is those who have no money." A bankrupt person has no money. A bankrupt person has no nothing. وَقَالَ رُسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ الْمُفْلِسْ مِنْ أُمَّتِي مَنْ يَأْتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالصِّيَامِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. A bankrupt person will come on a day of judgment and they will have the prayers and they will have the fasting and they will have the zakat. But وَقَدَ شَكَمَ هَذَا وَقَرَثَ هَذَا وَأَقَلَ مَالَ هَذَا وَسَفَكَ هَذَا وَضُرُبَ هَذَا. But this person would have reviled this person, defamed that person, stole the wealth of that person, shed the blood of that person, beat that person. Allah will take their good deeds from them, take from them all of their siyam, take from them their salat, take from them their zakat, take from them and give it to the person that they abused. And if you run out and there's no left, no prayers left, no siyam left, nothing left, no zakat left, no jihad left, no nothing left, Allah will take the bad deeds, the evil deeds of that person and put them on you and then throw you in the hellfire. This is a muflis. This scares me. Yes, you fasted Ramadan. Yes, you did good. But be careful for the rest of your life. You have to guard. Guard that ibadah. And make sure you don't blow it. That you won't backbite no one. That you don't slander no one. You want to make sure. So brothers and sisters, this is a glorious day. But we want to see Allah Yawm Qiyamah, inshallah. And we want to get the great reward. I conclude with this. I want to leave this for my parents. All of you I love very much. When you look around here, behold all the people that you hadn't seen sometimes in a while. Happy, this joyous occasion. Hugging each other, talking to one another. Watching each other walk. I'd like to ask you a question. How is it that you're able to speak? How is it that you're able to recite Al-Quran? How is it that you're able to walk? You may be tempted to say, Imam, I speak because God created me to speak. And I walk because God created me to walk. That's only part of the answer. But there is a deeper answer. The answer is this. The only reason you speak is you heard someone else speak. The only reason you walk is because you saw people walk. You said, no, Imam, God created me to speak. God created me to walk. I'll prove it to you. Today, when you get a chance, I want you to Google what is called feral children. F-E-R-A-L children. Feral children. What is a feral child? There's been 100 cases in the world of feral children. What is a feral child? A feral child is a child that's been neglected by their parents because of alcoholism or drug addiction to such a degree that the child, rather than being raised by the parents, is raised by animals. 100 cases. There was a girl, and they call her the wolf girl. She was raised literally by wolves. And that girl never stood up. That girl was on the falls just like a wolf. That girl never spoke. That girl howled like a wolf. Those children that were raised by dogs act just like dogs, sound just like dogs. Those who were raised by monkeys look, act just like monkeys. So brothers and sisters, the parents, I want to warn you that the Prophet said, "Kullu ra'in maqulun masulun an ra'yatihi." الإمام راهن وهو مسؤول عن رياته الإمام راهن ومسؤول عن رياته والرجل راهن في أهله وهو مسؤول عن رياته. Every one of you is a shepherd, and every one of you is held accountable for your flock. The Imam, he's a shepherd for the flock, and the father, he's a shepherd in his household, and the mother. So brothers and sisters, watch our children. You want to get some ajr from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Watch our children. How many of you ever about to get in your car and you got something in your hand, like coffee, and you put the coffee on top of the car, or put your bag on top of the car, and you get in the car and you forget and you drive off? Ever happened to you? 4 weeks ago in Arizona, a 23-year-old mother, about to get in her car, put her baby in the car seat, put the car seat on top of the car, got in the car and drove away, forgetting that the baby was on top of the car. Alhamdulillah, miraculously nothing happened to the baby. But the woman was arrested. You know why she was arrested? Because she was smoking marijuana and she was high. So brothers and sisters, you want to get some ajr to erase the bad deeds? One of the things that we can do, we can remember all those who are suffering around the world. There's enough Muslims suffering. If you don't believe me, what I just told you about a Muflis, just consider this. Most of you heard about Penn State, a famous university. And right now, Penn State is suffering because of sanctions. Why? Because of one man, Jerry Sandusky. abused young boys, and people around them saw it and did nothing about it. If they had followed one hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the school would have been okay. مَنْ رَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ. Whoever sees an evil, change it with his hand. If you can't change it with his hand, then change it with his tongue. If they had just done that, because they didn't do it, Penn State had sanctioned against it for $60 million. Scholarships were taken away from it. Joe Paterno, one of the most famous coaches in the history of this country, was number one. He had more wins than anyone else. But because he did nothing about it, 111 wins were struck, taken from him. So instead of being the first on the list, he's 12th on the list. Because they didn't stand up. We, the Muslims, have an opportunity to stand up. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish a woman in hellfire because of her mistreatment of a cat, what kind of punishment will Allah do when we murder human beings and Muslims? So all over the Muslim world, Muslims are suffering. Muslims are suffering in Syria. We ask Allah the Almighty to help those who are oppressed in Syria. We ask Allah the Almighty to strengthen them, to free them, to liberate them. We ask Allah the Almighty, those Muslims of Burma all over the world that are suffering, we ask Allah the Almighty to help them. Those Muslims in Bangladesh, Muslims in Pakistan, Muslims in Sierra Leone, Muslims in Africa, Muslims all over the world, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to strengthen them. We ask Allah the Almighty to forgive us our sins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our siyam, to accept our fasting for him, to accept our prayers for him. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به. واغفر عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and bless your families. Have a great evening. Allah Akbar.